Do you know?
Hi, thank you so much, Veronica. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, wonderful. Okay. It's a little funny from my end. This is the first time that I've done just an audio webinar, so my apologies if I'm a little rough starting. I'm used to having a little bit more visual from the people that I'm speaking to. So thank you, Veronica, for asking for my assistance on this project, and congratulations to you guys for doing such a wonderful job offering accessible training to people. So this morning, I thought when I'm thinking about what I would like to share in this hour to make it as useful as possible for the variety of service professionals that are listening to the webinar, I thought what I would share is some broad approaches to engaging this population. I have some questions that I want you to ask yourselves as you're engaging with this population. Ones that I have found helpful, ones that I have found most effective in working with this group of people. And because we are time limited, I think we're going to save some time at the end for question and answers. And then for further learning, I'm going to give you a list of some models and frameworks that I draw on that I found very helpful with this population. So I'd like to say thank you as well to all the people that are listening to the call and for your wonderful, insightful questions. So I think we received over 100 questions for this webinar itself, and they were quite thoughtful, and I wish that I could address all of them. So hopefully I can answer as many questions as possible throughout the webinar, and then there will be a little bit of time at the end if there's something that you feel wasn't addressed and you wanted to ask. So moving forward, I wanted to address a little bit of the group knowledge. So my question, because there is such a variety of support that is needed and that is being offered to people who've experienced human trafficking, my question to the group is, what type of support do you offer clients? And I think that it becomes really important for us to think about this, not only in this webinar, but for ourselves. It's my experience that it's important to be very clear on the limitations of what you're able to offer. So no single worker or agency can do it all, so to speak. And I think clients really need to know what they can expect from us. A lot of times this population has been used to not fitting with different mandates, has been used to less than helpful encounters with service providers, or not accessing service at all, or they might have a history of seeing service providers more as the enemy. So if they have a history of being involved with police or with children's aid, maybe more mandated services, there's a lot of mistrust already entering the room before you meet with the client. So I think it's really important to understand what you can and can't do and being able to be consistent with that. So if your role is limited to a drop-in resource, for example, then you know that you can't provide any kind of trauma therapy, but you can resource with the client. If your role is limited to assisting them with finding housing, it's important to know what the other resources that your client can use and help connect with them, because they will often come with a complex list of needs, things that, you know, that they need right away. And so they need to know, what can they get from you? And if you can't do it, can you connect them with somebody else that can? That really helps build trust too. Another question that I think is important for us to ask as professionals is, how do we understand our position in the context of their life? what really is my role, however small? What is my role in their life? I am asking to enter into a very private space in their world. So how do I understand my position in there? And how can I ensure that this position is helpful, thoughtful, and hopeful, and reduce, you know, being problematic in their life? Because I think sometimes we come in with ideas of what we can do or what we want to do for people, and it's not necessarily what they're looking for from us. So how do we really understand our position in their lives? And how does she or he understand our position? What are we to them? So these are kind of some ongoing questions that I found I have to continually come back to, and being clear about what I can do, what am I capable of, what kind of boundaries do I need to set up around this relationship. I think often I have found, and I don't know about anybody else, but especially with this population, I have found that my hope and my desire for what I can do far exceeds what I'm actually able to do. So this can be a very challenging population to work with, especially when their needs are so high. Another question that becomes really important, sort of from an anti-oppressive practice framework, is coming back to how do I understand this problem? Because that influences my work with these people. And what factors continue to influence my work with this population? So there are many limitations. It could be institutional and organizational. It can be my own understanding or my own skills and expertise that are limiting. It can be systemic issues that influence my understanding and my work about this population. And I think I've found more than any group that I work with, this question I continue to circle back to. And I continue to find myself becoming more and more aware of just how different dominant stories influence the work that we do with this group of people. So I'm just going to go ahead here to the next slide. So often you'll hear me talking about stories and the power of storytelling. And this has always been an area that I found really helpful in my work with people, especially people, groups of people who have been oppressed or marginalized. And the concept of storytelling for me dates back to a lot of history working with Aboriginal communities and populations in Northwestern Ontario. You will find throughout the presentation, I do draw heavily on narrative therapy as well, and I found that approach is very helpful with this population. So for those of you that are narrative therapists, you'll notice a lot of the concepts are familiar, and I think that they can apply really well to doing work with this group. So how do we as helpers co-create a space that encourages understanding of the multitude of stories that people experience? This becomes so primary, I think, especially with this population. I've worked in a variety of capacities, so I've actually done formal trauma therapy with this group. I've been an outreach worker, I've been a program manager, I've been, you know, just a drop-in counselor. And in any engagement with this population and with people in general, I do believe that any engagement you have has the potential to be therapeutic. So all of your encounters, however small, can be therapeutic. And I will say that some of the most powerful experiences I've had with this group, especially when we're talking about street-involved youth, haven't been in the formal counseling room. They have been when we're engaging sort of on their turf, on the street, in the drop-in, if we're engaging as part of a project. Those have been more therapeutic, I would say, is in the formal therapy. Formal therapy, we'll talk about that a little bit later in the webinar, but it's difficult to access and it takes a lot to get there. So most of the work I think you will be doing is in this sort of beginning phase where you're trying to get to know the person, understand their story, assess what they're looking for and how you can potentially be a part of that in their story and their journey moving forward. And I think when we move into the next part of the webinar, for me, the bottom bullet is really important. Our assumptions have the power to influence how other people see themselves, how others see them, and how they move forward in their life. And so it's really important to examine it, because at the end of the day, the only person that we really do have control over is ourselves. So our interaction with people and our constant reflection on that becomes primary for me in order to not further marginalize or oppress. I think it's important to note too that it's easy to get caught up in our own understanding of what human trafficking is, of what commercial sexual exploitation is, and I will draw a lot on commercial sexual exploitation. That's been the majority of my work. I haven't done work with forced labor. But I think it's really easy to get caught up in that kind of dominant story and in our own understanding of what that means. And that can be a barrier to working with this group. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. So I've got a group of questions. I wanted to explore some of the assumptions that we come with when working with this population. So we all come with our own lived experience, our own training and theory and understanding of what that means. We come with our own social location in the world. And when it comes down to working with people that have been trafficked, I think there's some working assumptions that we can use to benefit our work. So I'm going to talk a little bit about assumptions about people, assumptions about problems, assumptions about change, and assumptions about therapy. And so for your takeaways for today, I'm hoping that you can use some of these key kind of working assumptions in your work with trafficked people or people that have been exploited. So one of my favorite quotes is that people have the best intentions and they are doing their best to resolve their pain given their experiences and their skills. And I think this becomes a very important working assumption. So if we assume that people are doing the very best with what they have, we can assume resiliency, we can assume competencies, and we can assume that they come with a host of resources. I also like to assume that people have many abilities that are known and unknown to them, and often to us too, especially I think when we connect with people that may be in crisis. It can be really easy to focus on the crisis and to focus on the deficit and to focus on what people need that they don't have. And that's important for identifying in your assessment, okay, where are we going to go with this person? What kind of resources do they need? But there's also a lot of hidden abilities that it becomes our job to help make them known, both to ourselves and then in conversation with the client to help make it known to them. I will tell you that this will be a group of people that will test you, probably more than you've been tested by any other group that you've worked with. They will continually test you because many, many of them have learned that help comes with a price, that we must have an ulterior motive if we're engaged with them or if we're offering them something, because that's been their experience, that's what they've learned. Many of the young women and men that I've worked with, and I'm sure you guys will identify too, have this wall, this protective wall around them that they have had to put up. They're very, very used to being disappointed. And so, you know, when we think about clients that we label difficult to engage or difficult to serve or populations that are difficult to serve, that is about this protective wall that a lot of times they've had to put up. So our job is to really see the complexity in people's lives and to just help build bridges and to help build bridges of hope. So I was at a conference one time and one of the speakers said that we have to have insanely optimistic outcomes for people. So we have this kind of psychotic hopefulness that comes that doesn't discredit the pain and the trauma that people have experienced, but that at the end of the day, we can continue to hold out hope that they will use their skills, strengths, and competencies to live their best life on their terms. So I think when we come to this practice with this population, with those kind of working assumptions about people, it changes a little bit how we think about people. We see people less as victims. It's more easy for us to fight off this sort of rescue narrative that's pretty dominant in the human trafficking literature. And we start to see people as being resilient and strong. And we start to look at what they have used to overcome what they've already been through. How have they survived? Incredible strength with this population, if they let you see it. So you're going to have to work really hard, and there is definitely going to be a lot of challenges. I'm not going to lie to you. And it's par for the course. So that becomes about them testing, definitely testing. Can they trust us? Will we be consistent? Will we just bail? Will we say this is too hard and not be able to do it? Or will we continue to walk with them on their journey and however small our role is, will we continue to be part of their story? I think when we're thinking about how we help this population, it's really important that whoever you're working with co-defines the goals. So really having them lead how they think about what they need from us, what they want from us, what they're ready to do, what they're not willing to do. And, you know, as always, like all of us, we're more likely to do things that we come up with over things that we are mandated to do, told to do, shamed into doing, that sort of thing. So seeing your client as a strong leader in this whole process is really important. So assumptions about problems, and I use the term helpers because I'm not sure where people's experience in the group today is being drawn from. So I just broadly kind of labeled us all helpers, for lack of a better word. Some of us are therapists, some of us are managers, some of us are drop-in workers, some of us are developing programs or have an interest in this field because we suspect that they are part of our caseload, and they likely are. There probably is exploitation on your caseload that just hasn't been verbalized or identified. So all of us, I think, come into this work with people that have been trafficked with an assumption or desire to help. So we are always engaged in people's identity projects, and we help them know and understand who they are. And I think this becomes really important because with this issue, with commercial sexual exploitation, if this has been part of your story, if this has been something that you've experienced, how you understand yourself, how you label what has happened, talk about what has happened, process what has happened, is highly influenced by dominant culture. So how other people talk about your problem leads to you understanding your problem. So we can't control, to a great extent, some of the more systemic issues, but we can control our own understanding of the problem when we're working with clients. So even in the smallest moment, the smallest engagement that you have with a client, whether it's in a shelter or a drop-in area or whether they become part of your caseload because you're a therapist or a housing worker or a case manager, how we understand what the problem is will influence how we navigate it. And I think that, you know, drawing from more of a narrative kind of therapy approach, externalizing the problem has been very helpful in my work with this population. So the problem is not your client. The problem maybe is not the exploitation. It's that that happened. So not that it happened to them. I know that sounds a little bit confusing perhaps, but it's how they begin to identify and understand what it is. So they're not the problem. They are in a relationship with the problem. It becomes really important to listen and try to understand what the problem is on her turf, not yours. So like I said in the beginning, we come with some understandings of what human trafficking is, and it's really easy to get caught up in those dominant discourses. But let's tune that out for a minute when we're in the room with this client, and let's try to understand on her turf what that means to her. How does she see it? How does she understand it? So it's not our job to try and convince her to see it another way, because that usually doesn't work. And it will often, especially with the youth I've worked with, send them running in another direction. The more you try to convince someone to see it some way, the more they dig in their heels and defend their position. So don't try and get in a power struggle about this one, because it's not going to be effective. So rather than opposing meaning about the problem, explore the problem with the client. Understand that the problem is always influenced and maintained by systemic issues, social constructions, dominant stories, institutional factors. Those are always going to be present in your conversation about this, but your job is to try and see it through his or her eyes. This will help you see your client as a three-dimensional person, so not as a trafficking victim, not as somebody who needs to be rescued, not as somebody that needs to leave the game, not as somebody that's been abused, but as a whole person, because their story about the abuse is important, so is the rest of them, because that's what you're going to help them draw on to move forward. And when we talk about change, that becomes really important. So listening on her turf, being comfortable with their language, understanding that this problem, in my experience, comes with a whole culture too. There's a culture that goes along with commercial sexual exploitation. And so we think about cultural competency and cultural curiosity. It's that we can know what we read about a culture, but we can't possibly know what it means to be a member of that culture because we haven't been there. And even if we have, our experience is our own and not hers. So really getting to know your client outside of the problem. Who are they outside of this? Who are they if they're not a trafficked person, if they're not whatever other language they use to describe themselves, a street kid, a homeless person? Who are they outside of that? So assumptions about change. This is one that's, you know, really interesting. I think if you ask any helper, we all come with the best of intentions. That's sort of my assumption about people that are in the helping field, is that we do come to this with the best of intentions. But I think that we can sometimes get tripped up into what we think about change. So I want us to think about ourselves in the change process. Our role is being very small, but very influential. So I draw a lot on the stages of change model from Prochaska and DiClemente and a harm reduction approach in my work with street-engaged youth and at drop-in centers, as understanding that people go through different stages of change when they're approaching any kind of change becomes really important. So most of us will assume that change is always happening, that it's not linear. Small shifts that people have. These are some of the really rewarding moments that I've been able to bear witness to. And a lot of these times they don't happen in the therapy room. They happen when you're doing all the work to help get people into the therapy room, if that's sort of where it's going to be helpful, if they're going to eventually go on to trauma therapy to process some of the traumatic issues. These smaller shifts that you are a part of in your interactions with them lead up to the ability to make bigger changes. So being able to shift some of the shame and blame that the problem has caused, huge, in being able to not bear the burden of responsibility for the issue. I think that the shame of being involved in that has been a theme in pretty much everybody that I have worked with. And so a small shift that it's not their fault, they are not just the totality of the exploitation, has been very therapeutic in and of itself. So those small shifts lead up to bigger changes. Our thoughts and hopes and beliefs about change influences how we perceive what is possible. When you are working with a client that has a multitude of issues, it can be really difficult to not get caught up in the desperation of that, to not be dragged into just how very overwhelming it is. So our job in those moments is just to maintain our belief and our hope for this client that change is possible, especially when they cannot. Again, I go back to, it's not as important to just merely bear witness. We talk a lot, when we're doing trauma work about bearing witness and being with people in pain. This is absolutely important, but it's not enough to actively help someone shape change. It's essential, but it's not enough. So therapeutic conversations can be guided by the types of questions that we ask people. So are we simply listening to trauma? Are we witnessing the horror that they have been through? Are we guiding them with our questions to identify areas of strength and resiliency? Because that becomes part of the next conversation with them. The areas of strength and resiliency that they've had to draw on so far in their life and in their experience, and that they will continue to draw on however they move forward. I think sometimes as helpers, we make assumptions about what kind of change people need. And this population I found, because we are influenced by these dominant stories about people's experiences and what kind of help they need, what's going to help them get better, for lack of a better word, because as helpers, we're always trying to move people forward. So we start to make assumptions about what is going to help. And here's where we need to go back to asking ourselves, doing those self-reflection questions, and to going back to the client's understanding of what the problem is. So the problem might be that they need housing. How did they identify that? The problem might be that they aren't ready to move on out of, their relationship with their pimp or their exploiter. But they are ready to make a smaller shift in another part of their life. So start with that. I think we get caught up in thinking that it has to be almost like an abstinence-based model where they have to be completely removed in order for effective change to happen, and that we're driving the change, and that's how we lose a lot of clients. So let the client drive the change. And hold out hope and go back to your assumptions that people are doing their very best where they are with what they've got. And the more you go back to these assumptions about change, your assumptions about problems, your assumptions about people, the stronger you can build that therapeutic foundation. that is the biggest part of your role with this population, is building that safe, trusting, non-judgmental relationship, because that becomes the foundation for which people can launch other change from. So even if you see a client that you suspect or that you know or that she's evaded to is involved in human trafficking or sexual exploitation in some way, but your role is not a human trafficking worker, maybe she comes to see you regularly for addictions issues because she's decided that this is an area of her life that she's ready to make a change on. When she's ready to move in other areas of her life, because she has that relationship established with you, you are probably, in all likelihood, the helper that she goes to for help for other resources. That's very powerful. And that, when I have, my experience has been when I've engaged with youth or with women that are street involved, our initial engagement is not about the exploitation or the trafficking at all. Our engagement is around other things. Maybe it's about that we can provide concrete supplies that she needs. And, you know, she has come to understand that when she comes in, she gets a consistent, supportive response. And we start talking more and more and more and more. And that's how your trust is built. And then when she's ready to make a change, you are one of the people that she can come to. So this takes patience, absolutely, and it takes a bit of letting go as a worker to our sort of preconceived notions of what's going to help her, what's going to make her life better. It can be very frustrating when you're working with clients that are continually victimized and continue to go through the cycle of abuse. It's certainly difficult. So when you're thinking about your self-care as a worker, that becomes primary. It's also very difficult, I will say, to have your entire caseload made up of people that have experienced human trafficking or sexual exploitation. So there is a lot of value in being having your expertise in human trafficking, having your expertise in trauma therapy, for example. This population is very difficult to carry a full caseload of. And I think it's actually coming out in some talks between agencies in Toronto that one of the best practices for this population is that it is not your entire caseload. And I will speak from experience that it's very, very difficult to have, you know, 15, 20, 25 different people that have been trafficked, and that's your the totality of your caseload. Very, very difficult as a worker to hold that. So assumptions about change as well is important. There we go. Assumptions about therapy. So therapy with this population is tricky. Therapy with any population is tricky. I want you to think about, as a worker, do we begin with the end in mind, or do we start where the client is at? Now, that old mantra, that old social work mantra, start where the client is at. I think we say that a lot of times in the field, but we don't really do that well. I think a lot of times we start with the end in mind. And a lot of our social service delivery now is very project focused, and we have outcomes that we need to report on, and funders want to see, you know, projected success. And so we start our engagement with the end in mind. So whether that the client will, you know, reduce substance use, the client will be housed, the client will leave the exploitative relationship, the client will testify, whatever it is, we're kind of beginning our interaction with that in mind. So starting where the client is at puts you in a very different position. It asks you to leave behind your program mandates for now. It challenges you to step out of your institutional and organizational limitations and really enter into her turf and her experience. It also asks you to remind yourself that we are pulled by our own history. We are guided and directed by our own experiences, by our agency's mandate, by our training, by our understanding of this issue. We are heavily influenced by dominant stories. Like I said before, a non-judgmental stance is necessary, but it's not enough to facilitate change. Same with bearing witness. It's not enough to help clients move forward, to simply listen. Our job is not passive. And I think that everybody on the webinar can appreciate that is very active. You are actively engaged. You'll expend a tremendous amount of energy on this population. Lived experience, I want to talk briefly about this. Lived experience is as valuable as theory. So I want to talk a little bit about what I meant by that. It's not my intent to disavow therapist skills and knowledge, but I want us to draw on it in a different way. We come to this with understanding, knowledge, skills, and expertise in our areas that can be of great value. We can be an excellent resource to our client. But I want us to draw on that in a little bit of a different way. So we don't enter into our relationship as the expert. We recognize, I think pretty much everybody in this field will say that, yes, I recognize that the client is the expert on their experience and I'm not. Easy to say, harder to do. How do we demonstrate that to our client? How do we demonstrate that her lived experience is just as valuable as any theory about any kind of therapy or stages of change or framework for practice that I bring? It becomes more of a collaborative inquiry when you value that just as much as your theory. So it becomes about her ability to be empowered, her or his ability to draw on that experience as a catalyst for understanding the type of person they are, understanding who they are, understanding their identity, that they are strong, that they are resilient, and that they are more than this experience. So her experience in the room is primary. And I think what you're really asking people to do in therapy, if you do therapy with this population, you're extending them an invitation to collaborate. So even in non-therapeutic settings, really that's what we're asking people to do. We're giving them an invitation to collaborate with us. And our job is not so much, when we go back to our assumptions about people and change and problems, our job is not to simply identify and name the problem and then name the solution. Our job is to construct knowledge together, so it becomes more of an egalitarian relationship. It becomes more directed by the client's understanding of the problem and by the client's desire to change different pieces in their life or to continue their life, that they have the option to continue their life as they choose to, and that they will still be valued and respected and seen as resilient human beings. Coming back to the question, why should they trust us? This is one of the questions that your clients will consciously or unconsciously ask you throughout your entire relationship. Why should they trust us? We are actually asking them to do an incredible thing, and that is to trust us and to share with us some of the most intimate details of their lives. So, you know, when we think about storytelling and we think about the client as the storyteller and us as the listener, it becomes an incredible honor to have someone share their story and their life with you. And I think when you operate with that, when you start with that in mind, that you are listening to a client's story, whether your job is as a case manager, a housing worker, a drop-in worker, therapist, doesn't matter. You are starting where they are, and you are witnessing their story with them. So that is a different kind of starting point than beginning with the end in mind. And I think that is something that we constantly have to come back to. This population, more than any population, I have found supervision, self-reflection, questioning of my own self has been prominent in my work with this population in order to be able to be resilient myself. That's been something that I've had to continually go back to. And again, when you're starting where the client is at, we are leaving behind dominant constructions of human trafficking. We are not caught up in dominant discourses about what that means, because we are trying to listen to the storyteller, and that is your client. So understanding her story and her position. And I'm aware of the time. So what I wanted to leave you with, we do have some time for questions. I know that is important, and I'm sure there's a ton of questions. I wanted to leave you with some frameworks for practice that I utilize with this population that I have found most helpful. I'm sure there are many, many others. These are just, again, from my personal and professional experience that I wanted to share. Number one, AOP, coming back to being anti-oppressive, doing no harm. I think as helpers, we often have the best intentions, but we end up hurting people. Collaborative inquiry, co-constructing knowledge with participants. Stages of change model, important to familiarize with that. A lot of really good work from the harm reduction literature that's been very effective in this work. Triphasic approach to trauma therapy. Again, as with other populations, but with this population, your work will be in phase one. Your work will be safety and stabilization, building of trust, therapeutic relationship. It will be continually moving back to this phase. Whether you're a therapist or not, you are doing a lot of this work. It's phase one, trauma work. And a narrative framework. Draw a lot on a narrative framework with this population, and I think it dovetails really nicely with anti-oppressive practice. Now, that is it for my slides today. So I think what Veronica has asked is that we open up for questions from people. We have, by my clock, we have about 10 or so minutes left. So I'm going to turn it back over to Veronica.
Thank you so much, Jolene. This is great. I've always admired your presentation for the honesty and being so heartfelt. We've had a couple of questions coming throughout the webinar. Not too many so far, but I do encourage people to continue typing their questions in the chat box. So just to start us off, you mentioned this briefly, and it's something we've tried to address in our training, so I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit. Obviously, we're in this field, people work are exposed to the traumatic experiences of others. So how do you protect yourself as a worker in this field? Can you perhaps share some tips on self-care? Jolene?
So I missed the first part, the question about the training. So maybe what I'll do is I'll address the second part, the self-care part.
It was just the self-care part. I was.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Sorry. So self-care for me, I think, has definitely been a learning journey. So having a strong network of support has been very important for me. Getting my own support outside of the agency, whether that's formal support through a therapist because of vicarious trauma issues, frustrations. I think I'll be honest, as a frontline worker, for me, it was less about, you know, the vicarious trauma, and it became more about the frustrations with the lack of resources for this population. That continually really frustrated me. I think that as workers, we advocate and we fight and we fight as much as we can, and then it just seems like there's never enough. There's never enough services that are applicable. There's never enough housing. There's never enough access to resources outside of the game, for lack of a better word. That for me became very frustrating as a worker, and so that's where I had to get my help with. I think one of the most important things, very honestly as well, I'm in private practice now, and I do have some of my caseload have experienced trauma, a huge portion of the caseload. Some of it is sexual exploitation, and having a balance of clients that haven't experienced this issue helps me to be a more resilient therapist. I found it very difficult to manage high caseloads, high crisis, all trafficking, all having experienced trafficking. That was very, very difficult. So either the smaller caseloads or balancing caseloads so that one worker doesn't just take the human trafficking. I think that would have been very helpful for me in community.
Thank you, Jolene. A practical question, whether a copy of these slides is available. So just let people know, the full recording of the webinar will be posted on our training website very likely next week. And my colleague, Genia, will inform everybody once that's done and send you the link to it. So you will have a copy of the slides. Now, moving on with the question, since we still have a few minutes, another thing I wanted to, you mentioned narrative therapy as something that's very effective when working in, with an Aboriginal, with Aboriginal clients. And the question is that something that you think might be useful when working with different populations, say clients who are newcomers, for example, in an international trafficking scenario, or any other situation?
Sorry, Veronica, can you repeat the question? So which piece would I think would be helpful?
Absolutely. So it's the question was about narrative therapy, which you had mentioned using with Aboriginal clients. So the question is whether narrative therapy is something that might be useful with a broader client group, not only with Aboriginal clients.
Absolutely. So yeah, I have used narrative therapy approaches with many different clients. And for trauma, I think, you know, some of the core pieces about narrative therapy are externalizing the problem. It influences our understanding of what the problem is. And I found that very helpful with this group. So yes, absolutely. It's evidence-based. So it's a model that can be used sort of across groups.
Thank you, Jolene. Another question from a law student who is writing about sexual exploitation of children. And the question is, are safe houses a good way to help them? So I believe them in this case means children in an exploitative situation.
I think there needs to be more safe houses. I think there's not enough residential programs, both for children, for youth, and for adults. So when I was in community, a big part of my role was to try and advocate for more funding for that. I think there is an absolute disparity of resources. I think the residential model can be very helpful. They've had a lot of success with it in Winnipeg, for example. Spirit of Our Little Sisters housing is probably one of the best in Canada. They have had a lot of success using a residential model with youth that have experienced commercial sexual exploitation. And I think that, you know, to add for that, one of the things that is most helpful about the model that they use is they have a variety of staff that come with a variety of different training and expertise, including lived experience. And that becomes very important when working with this population, is to honor the knowledge that lived experience provides. And they you know, do a really good job in Winnipeg of coordinating services. So they coordinate cross-sector, and I think that that is why they've been able to be so resilient in helping this population.
Thank you, Jolene. I think we're going to take the last question, and this is, do you think there is a place for federal or provincial policy in addressing the systemic issues that have created this problem and in harm reduction?
So I would say yes, because with policy often comes funding, comes awareness of the issue. I think that, with harm reduction policies, there is a lot of harm reduction policies in place. It's a model that's been used with a lot of different issues, most notably with addictions, but is more understood with mental health as well, and with addressing homeless population, and with addressing this population as well. So I think that there definitely does need to be more work on why people get caught up in commercial sexual exploitation. What are our resources available for people? What do we really have to offer people when they're thinking of leaving exploitation, or when they are able to leave a human trafficking? It's often a huge struggle for them to, and for workers, to connect them with necessary resources. And so time and time again, people will go back. And I think that, that is a failure on our country's part, that we make that a better option than being outside of that. So I think there is a lot of work that can be done more at a federal or a provincial level.
Thank you so much, Jolene. Unfortunately, we are close to 11:30, so we will have to wrap up. However, if you think of any questions that you were not able to ask during the webinar, please feel free to contact us afterward, and we'll do our best to respond. Also, I just wanted to mention briefly that there have been some questions around how can you identify a trafficked person, and what can the general public do in this sense? What other resources are there? One of the participants was recommending, in addition to our training, the training that's put out by OCTIP in British Columbia, an online training, which is extremely helpful. Also, a training for foster parents at www.ocwtc.net. For more resources, I encourage everybody to access our website, helpingtraffickedpersons.org, where we do have lists of resources and links. And you can always get in touch with us. Once again, thank you so much, Jolene, for being with us today and sharing such a wealth of information. I would like to thank all the participants as well for being here today, and I hope that you have found this webinar useful. Just as a reminder, we have one last webinar in this series coming up in March 25th, and it will be, the speaker will be Lisa. Lisa is a survivor of human trafficking, and for those of you who have attended November's webinar, we have Caroline, who has been exploited in the commercial sex trade. Lisa will talk about her story, which is a story that we hear less about, having been forced into performing illegal activities. So once again, that's March 25th at 10 a.m., and you will be receiving an invitation a few weeks before the date. As you access the webinar today, you will see a very short questionnaire. We would really, really appreciate your feedback. So if you could take a couple of minutes to fill that out, that'd be great. And again, if you ever want to get in touch with our team here, if you have any questions or need information, and you feel we may be able to help, I'm Veronica. My contact information is on screen. Brooke Stewart is the project coordinator working currently on developing our new shorter versions of the training, specifically for law enforcement, legal staff, healthcare professionals, and service providers in the children's services sector. And Evgenia coordinates the webinar series, so if you need any information about the webinar, feel free to reach out to her. So thank you, everybody, and I wish you all a great day and a wonderful weekend.